earlier this year, 2025, doctors in California successfully transplanted a bladder into a living patient for the first time ever. Thanks to this surgery, the patient, who lost his bladder due to cancer, was able to pee on his own for the first time in 7 years. This moment is a major advance in organ transplant history, but it kinda seems like it shouldn't have taken us this long to get here. I mean, the first successful human organ transplant dates back to 1954. That was the kidney. And we've been doing heart transplants since the 1960s and lungs since the 1980s. But the bladder has enough hidden complexity and medical trade-offs that we couldn't transplant one until 2025! So here's why it took humanity so long to transplant bladders and how we overcame those obstacles. We all pee, but some of us take it for granted. You could have been born with a neurological condition that makes it hard or even impossible to control your bladder. These conditions are more common than you might think. For instance, one of the most common birth defects out there is spina bifida, occurring in around 1 in every 2,900 births. This happens when your spine does not fuse properly during development. Then, in some cases, spinal cord nerves don't form properly, and those nerves are supposed to direct your bladder's filling and emptying. So all of this can lead to problems peeing. Fundamentally, bladders are just bags that hold urine until we're ready to pee. So they don't sound complex at all until you learn about all the stuff around them. At some point, you need to empty the bag, and that happens thanks to electrical signals from your brain that tells muscles in and around your bladder to push the pee out. Without those signals and muscles, you would have no control over when and where you pee. So bladders are entirely dependent on the nervous system for instruction. Your brain tells your bladder muscles to stay relaxed while you're filling your bladder. Then, when it's time to go, your central nervous system signals to clench bladder muscles and relax sphincter muscles to let out your pee. So if you need a bladder transplant, it's not enough to just stick a new bladder in your body. You need to hope that your nerves send the right information to that bladder, because that's not always a given. In contrast, your heart has its own electrical system separate from the central nervous system. So it's shockingly simpler to transplant a heart in some ways. But neurological conditions that mess with your central nervous system aren't the biggest reason people need bladder transplants. That title goes to cancer. In 1 year, more than 500,000 people get diagnosed with bladder cancer, and worldwide, it's a major cause of cancer-related death, especially in lower-income countries. So to keep you from dying of bladder cancer, doctors sometimes remove your bladder in a surgery called a cystectomy. But without a bladder, you definitely can't control your pee, so you can imagine that someone living without a bladder might like a new one? The thing is, there are more complications to bladder transplants than connecting to nearby nerves. Your pelvis has a lot of complicated blood vessels in it, so doctors have struggled to successfully hook bladders up to the circulatory system because there's just so much going on down there. Not to mention, your body might reject the new organ, so people who receive organ transplants usually need to be on immunosuppressant drugs for the rest of their lives. And since over 90% of cystectomies are due to bladder cancer, it's kind of a tough sell to compromise your immune system and risk more cancer for your new bladder, especially because you can live without your bladder. It's cumbersome, but you can do it. There's two main ways doctors currently get around the whole no bladder thing. One is through an ileal conduit and stoma. Basically, your pee doesn't come from your bladder, it gets stored there. It's made in your kidneys. If you take the end of your kidneys that usually funnels into your bladder and attach a piece of your small intestine to them, you end up with enough slack to redirect that flow somewhere else, generally through a hole that your doctor makes in your abdomen near your belly button. Then you can attach a bag called the ostomy bag to that opening called the ileal conduit to catch your pee. And you'd empty that bag at your convenience, kind of like you'd empty your bladder if you had one, but it's a lot harder to scroll on your phone while you empty an ostomy bag because your hands are busy. There's some pretty big downsides to this. One is that you're peeing into a bag strapped to your body and you have no control over how much comes out of you and when. You also have to keep the hole and the piece of intestine sticking out of your body really clean, so There's a lot of maintenance, which is enough for some people to opt for a neobladder instead. This is also a repurposed piece of your small intestine, but instead of acting as a conduit, it's more of a bladder replacement. People who have neobladders tend to have better control over when they pee, but they still come with some issues. One of those issues is because your pee is acidic. Doctors recommend that your pee averages a daily pH of 6, which isn't quite lime juice, but there's more going on than a glass of water. And having acid swirling around your bladder is fine, but just like stomach acid, it's best if it stays where it's meant to be. Unfortunately, neobladders don't keep urine contained the same way a bladder would. Remember, neobladders are made of small intestine, which literally exists to absorb things. So sometimes neobladders soak up pee and you end up upsetting the whole chemical balance of your body. One common outcome of neobladder surgery is a condition called metabolic acidosis, where your blood acid level is way too high. And since your kidneys are supposed to regulate your blood acid levels, metabolic acidosis can lead to kidney failure. That would make neobladders a less than ideal solution. But don't worry, researchers have been batting around other bladder remedies for decades. But first, all science needs funding, so here's an ad. Thank you for watching SciShow. We think these videos and all the great information in them should always be available for anyone who wants to watch them. And you can help keep that possible by participating in the second annual Complexly Learnathon. On November 3rd, we're kicking off a celebration of learning and the free content we make here at SciShow, Crash Course, and all of Complexly. We had so much fun last year, we had to do it again. There will be activities, videos, and live streams, and we have lots of opportunities for you to support our shows, including some very cool new merch. Mark your calendars and go to complexlylearnathon.com to check out the schedule of events. One of the first experiments dates back to 1917, when a scientist used connective tissue to make a bladder replacement in dogs. It wasn't a huge success, resulting in hemorrhage from the operation. Technically, it wasn't a failure of the bladder to do bladder stuff, but the later human attempts weren't much better. In the 1950s, doctors created fake bladders out of silicone and inserted them into 34 patients who'd had cystectomies. Unfortunately, a lot of the patients died, which stopped experts from doing that again, and meant that the survivors had their silicone bladders removed to prevent even more death. Not really the outcome we're looking for. Things weren't going so well in the transplant world either. By 1987, doctors tried to do a partial transplant into a 32-year-old using the bladder of an infant. This worked until it didn't. The patient's immune system rejected the transplant about 5 months later. It really wasn't until the 21st century that doctors started seeing some success beyond the small intestine method. A big breakthrough moment came in the early aughts when they created neobladders for 7 kids with a severe form of spina bifida. This time, the neobladders were created from the patient's own bladder cells. This seemed to be an effective way to prevent the kids' immune systems from rejecting their new bladders, because 4 years down the road, their were no hiccups. Before these neobladders were implanted, the children leaked pee as often as every 30 minutes. The cell-grown bladders weren't perfect, but they helped the kids hold more pee and control when they peed more effectively. But there's a reason we're still talking about transplants in 2025. Another attempt a few years later failed when similar cell-grown bladders ruptured. They're pretty tough to get right. Not only is pee acidic, but it can also contain toxins. So having all of that pee around discourages stem cells from growing, meaning that a lot of these cell-grown bladders just scar up and stop working. Despite setbacks, the last few years have been full of excitement around cell-grown bladders. The success of that trial with 7 kids means that people have poured a lot of time and money into this line of research. But we are still a long way from using home-brewed bladders. So, like it or not, transplants are kind of the alternative to the bladderless lifestyle today. And transplants haven't been all smooth sailing either. The first partial transplant happened back in 2008 when doctors successfully patched a bladder from a 2-year-old into a 1-year-old kid. Progress! But before we got to a full bladder transplant, we needed to solve the vasculature issue. Through practice on corpses and brain-dead donors, doctors eventually figured out that they could simplify the surgery by connecting some blood vessels to each other while the bladder was still on ice. Finally, it was time to test it out on a real living patient, but they needed someone for whom the trade-offs made sense. That person ended up being Oscar Lorenza, a 41-year-old cancer survivor. Lorenza was on dialysis necrosis, and this had damaged his small intestine to the point that it couldn't really be used for a neobladder or in an ileal conduit. He was also in need of a kidney transplant, so even though he was a cancer survivor, he was going to be on immunosuppressants anyway. The trade-offs were trade-offing. Lorenza was an excellent candidate for the bladder transplant. On May 4th, 2025, Lorenza went into surgery. He came out with the two-for-one deal of the century, a new kidney and a new bladder. A few days later, he was able to pee for the first time in years. This news is still too new to know how this full bladder transplant will work out in the long run, but the immediate results are pretty awesome. It's not clear yet if bladder transplants will stick around. Lorenza's body could still reject the new bladder, and we don't know what the long-term side effects might be, but hopefully they'll be sorted out through future clinical trials. Lorenza's transplant is part of a larger experiment to test out the viability of bladder transplants, so more should be coming soon. Okay, the video is over now. I know you've been thinking about it since you saw the title. You can finally go to the bathroom. Me too.